Hello. So we are going to talk about I Too Sing America by Julia Alvarez. So we've already read I Hear America Singing by Walt Whitman and I Too by Langston Hughes, talking about their views of America and the inclusion or lack of inclusion thereof. So we're going to go to a third poem, I Too Sing America, which has an accent in it, so it would be pronounced differently than I'm pronouncing it, by Julia Alvarez. And this is from 2008. So we have a poem from the 1800s, one from 1930s, and this one from 2008. Now you should have already read this poem. I'm not going to read it out loud because I don't speak Spanish and don't want to mispronounce these words, but we are going to break it down and look at some of the symbolism and the images. So, starting at the beginning, Alvarez says, "I know it's been said before, but not in this voice." So, just right off at the start, she's acknowledging Hughes and Whitman and the fact that she's riffing off of the conversation that they've had. And you can almost imagine like the three of them in a room talking together, having this conversation, and she's like coming on in and saying, "Hey, I want to say something too." So she's listing the elements that she can bring to the conversation or the voice that has not been included. So talking about the planto, which is a plantain, you know, is the banana, you know, that looks kind of like a banana, except that it's bigger and starchier. And the mango and the marimba and the bongo. So all of these words and elements that are of Hispanic origin. So she's saying that these things haven't been included. And also of English and Spanish. So with English and Spanish. So we know that this poem is going to be bilingual. It's going to include both English and Spanish. So it's her turn, she says, to say what she sees about America. And she also asserts that she has America inside of her, with all America inside me. Yeah. So she's asserting her place in America and that she does contain America inside of her. And then here we have a really neat image of a dancer. So if we look, starting on line 16, from the soles of the Tierra del Fuego to the thin waist of Chiquira, up the spine of Mississippi, through the heartland of Yonkers, to the great plain face of Canada, all of us sing America. So the soles, which would be the feet of Tierra del Fuego. So if you want to think of, so Tierra del Fuego, if you look down here in your little key, it says it's the southern tip of South America. So she's saying that the feet are the very bottom southern tip of South America and that the waist is where Panama is, and that the torso and the spine is up the spine of the Mississippi through the heartland of the Yankees, which is the US citizen. So, like the part that we think of as the United States is the torso of the dancer. To the great plain face of Canada, so Canada is the face of the dancer. So like one giant person across all of the American continents. All of us sing America. So she has expanded her poem or her song from the United States of America and from a nationality to the entire, the hemisphere, all of the American continents. So she's saying that they are singing their brown skin into that white and red and blue song. So she has the colors of America, red, white, and blue, but she's put white and listed it at the end of the line. So emphasizing the idea or the image of the Hispanic heritage and the Hispanic people being welcomed into the white community, and then adding Red and Blue Song. It's a big song that sings America, all America. And it says that all can sing, both in Spanish and in English, and it's a new song. So this new song is that everyone can be included. This is our moment under the sun that shines on everyone. So hit it, maestro. So a very fun, joyful phrase, ready for the dancer that has mentioned to dance. Give us that Latin beat. Unos, dos, tres, one, two, three. So counting to three in both languages. And yes, bilingually. And she says, I too am America, in both English and in Spanish. Okay? So that's kind of a breakdown of hers. You have the image of the dancer, you have the bilingual nature, both Spanish and English, showing that they are equal in their importance and place in the United States and in the American culture. So, included with this poem, we have an article that she wrote. And here's a picture of Miss Alvarez, maybe Mrs., I don't know her marital status. So, let's have a look at that. I would never have become a writer unless my family had immigrated to the United States when I was 10 years old. I grew up in the 50s in a dictatorship in the little Caribbean half island of the Dominican Republic. Although it was a highly oral culture, rich in storytelling, it was not a literary culture. I grew up among people who thought of reading as an antisocial activity that could ruin your health and definitely take the fun out of life. Reading, studying was not an activity that was encouraged in my family, especially for us girls. My grandmother, who only went up to fourth grade, used to tell the story that she only picked up a book when she had heard the teacher's donkey braying as it climbed up the hill to her house. Boys had to make the sacrificio and get an education in order to earn a living, but in moderation. So the idea that it was a sacrifice that the boys had to have a full education so that they could make money. My cousin was considered strange because he not only loved to read as a teenager, but as a teenager began to write poetry. Se va a enfermar, my aunt would say, shaking her head every time she found Juan sitting in a chair reading a book. He's going to get sick. I was also growing up in a repressive and dangerous dictatorship. In a social studies class, a student wrote an essay in which he praised Trujillo, the dictator, as the true father of our country. The teacher commented that certainly Trujillo was one of the fathers of our country, but there were others. The boy, the son of a general, must have gone home and told his father. That night, the teacher, his wife, and his two young children disappeared. Intellectuals, people who read and questioned, were suspect. A book in your hands might as well have been contraband. In 1960, my father's underground activities against Trujillo were discovered, and we were forced to escape the country in a hurry. The minute we landed on American soil, we became Spics, which, of course, is a derogatory term for people of Hispanic background, who spoke our English with heavy accents. Immigrants with no money or prospects. Overnight, we had lost everything: our country, our home, our extended family structure, our language. For Spanish was the language of home, of la familia, of self-understanding. We arrived in the United States at a time in history when that was not very welcoming to people who were different, whose skins were a different color, whose language didn't sound like English. For the first time in my life, I experienced prejudice, and playground cruelty. I struggled with a language and a culture I didn't understand. I was homesick and heartbroken. My sisters and I, being young, soon rallied to the challenge. We learned the new language, the new music, the new ways to dress and behave ourselves, but our success on these fronts soon created another kind of problem for our family. My parents wanted desperately to keep us to the old standards, and yet they also wanted us to succeed in this new culture. How could we study hard and earn all A's and get ahead, but be sweet and submissive and let Pappy make all the decisions? How could we remember our Spanish when we were forced to speak only English outside the home? How could we keep our mouths shut out of respect for our parents when in school we were being taught to speak up and debate if need be with our teachers? How could we get along with our friends and yet never go over to their houses for parties and sleepovers because they might have older brothers or parents who allowed things my parents did not allow? My sisters and I were caught between worlds, value systems, language, customs, and this was our challenge, which is the challenge for many of us who are immigrants into a new world that is different from the old one of childhood. How to maintain a connection to our traditions, our roots, and also to grow and flourish in our new country. How to find creative ways to combine our different worlds, values, conflicting and sometimes warring parts of ourselves so that we can become more expansive, not more diminished as human beings. But the problem was that no one was thinking like that back in those days. This was the United States of the early 60s, still locked in the civil rights struggles, pre-women's movement, pre-equal rights amendment movement, pre-multicultural studies, pre-anything but the melting pot. That old assimilationist mainstreaming model. Those were the days when the model for immigration was that you came to America, you assimilated, you cut off your ties to the past and old ways, and that was the price you paid for the privilege of being an American citizen. But sometimes it is these painful moments that can become opportunities for expansion and self-creation. I had become a hybrid, as all of us who travel beyond an original self or hometown or homeland are bound to become. I was not a mainstream American girl, and I wasn't a totally Dominican girl anymore. And yet, I wanted desperately to belong somewhere. It was this intense loneliness and desire to connect with others that led me to books. Homesick and lonely in the United States, I soon discovered that the world of the imagination was a portable homeland where everybody belonged. I began to dream that maybe I, too, could create worlds where no one would be barred. And so it was through the wide open doors of its literature that I truly entered this country. Reading Mr. Walt Whitman, I heard America's promise, and I fell in love with my new country. I hear America singing, its varied carols I hear. As for melting all our variety into one mainstream model, Mr. Whitman disagreed. I am large. I contain multitudes. This country was a nation of nations, a congregation of races. I resist anything better than my own diversity. Was this allowed? I wondered, looking over my shoulder. Wasn't this subversive? But Mr. Whitman's poems were printed in my English textbook, where he was described as the poet of America. He was saying what this country was really about, although America seemed to have forgotten its promises. Its writers remembered and reminded us. Slowly and not without struggle, America began to listen. As the 1960s progressed into the 70s, the country around me began to change. Under pressure from its own marginalized populations and from its growing number of immigrants, the nation was being forced to acknowledge its own diversity and become more inclusive. Citizens were challenging America to be true to its promises. The first time I attended a march in support of the Equal Rights Amendment to the Constitution and was not hauled off to be tortured in a dark prison chamber by the secret police, I understood that a free country was not one that was free of problems or inequalities or even hypocrisies. Such failures came with the territory of being a human being. Freedom was the opportunity to shape a country, to contribute to the ongoing experiment, never tried before, of making out of the many one nation, indivisible with liberty and justice for all. The words were not just rhetoric. It was our right and responsibility to make the words come true for ourselves and for others. As the nation changed, our literature began to reflect these changes as well. Not only was there a Mr. Whitman, I discovered, but a Mr. Langston Hughes. And here we have the poem, I Too Sing America, by Hughes. So I'll read the last line. They'd see how beautiful I am and be ashamed. I too am America. Oh, that was music to my ears. I understood what Mr. Hughes was saying. He was claiming his place in the chorus of the American song. This was an important voice for a young girl of another culture and language and background to hear. Whitman's I Hear America Singing, published in 1860, and here we have this, which we've read. In the preface to his most well-known and influential work, Leaves of Grass, Whitman has this to say about the poet's relationship to his or her country. The proof of a poet is that his country absorbs him as affectionately as he absorbs it. Here, Whitman claims that the measure of a poet is how well he or she speaks the voice of the country. Whitman, in his poems, seeks to articulate the idea of America and what it means to be American. I Hear America Singing exemplifies this goal of Whitman's. And then the rest are questions, so we're going to stop there. All right, so this is her essay about her experience. And maybe some items or some ideas jumped out at you. Some of the things that jumped out at me were when she talked about the assimilationist mainstream model. So we remember this word assimilationist from A Raisin in the Sun, and it means somebody who comes from a different background and into a new place, and they change everything about themselves to fit in to that new culture and that new environment. So in A Raisin in the Sun, it was used as an insult that black people had become assimilationists. They had assimilated into the American culture and had forgotten, hypothetically, their African roots. And so Asiaga uses that as kind of a derogatory, looking down term. You're an assimilationist, right? And George was an example of an assimilationist because he had completely bought into that American ideal of building wealth and being looking for an upper class, trying to be upper class, right? So the idea of immigrants and this assimilationist mainstreaming model is that you were supposed to cut off everything that was before and become the same as the people who were born and raised in America. So speaking the same language, adopting the same customs, the same culture. And that was, you just had to do that. She says, it was the price you paid for the privilege of being an American citizen. And so you've probably heard the term melting pot. So a melting pot, everything loses its original shape and melts into one big blob that could be formed into something else. In this case, the United States. But she says that that was difficult because she's caught between these two worlds, embracing the new world and also honoring the world she came from and her parents, of course, who want them to follow the rules that they were raised with. And then she discovers Whitman, and Whitman says, "I am large and I contain multitudes." And Whitman is more about individuality and being who you are. And we'll talk more about him too later in the year, right? So as we come into the 60s and we're talking about the civil rights movement, and she's talking about learning about diversity. So citizens were challenging America to be true to its promises, that promise that everyone is created equal or should have equal opportunity. And she realized that the country was free, not of problems, but it was free because you were able to express yourself without being arrested and tortured and all the things that happens in a dictatorship. So freedom, she says, freedom is the opportunity to shape a country. Right? So helping to create the country, which she does by writing her poetry and her songs, or her stories, sorry. So she says that the idea that making out of many one nation, indivisible with liberty and justice for all, is not just rhetoric, right? It is the responsibility to make those words true for ourselves and others. So that is the analysis of Miss Alvarez's poem and also some discussion of her personal essay about coming to America. And you're welcome to use any part of those, of course, for your upcoming paper.